Well, welcome everyone to our midweek Bible study. I say midweek this week because we're airing on Facebook on Thursday instead of Wednesday. But we're delighted to have you with us as we continue our study in this life-changing book, the indwelling life of Christ, all of Him in all of me. It's all about the Christ life. There's only one person who's ever lived the Christian life, and His name is Jesus Christ. And He wants to live His life through you and through me. That's what this study is all about. We're looking at the 19th chapter this week, and the chapter is titled Real Spirituality. And Major Ian Thomas begins by making this statement. It's not the nature of what you do that determines the spirituality of any action, but the origin of what you do. Now, I want to read that again. That's what this study is about. It's not the nature of what you do that determines the spirituality of any action, but the origin of what you do. He continues, there was never a moment in the life of our Lord Jesus that was without divine significance, because there was never anything He did, never anything He said, never any step He took, which did not spring from a divine origin. There was nothing in His life that was not the activity of the Father in and through the Son. He lived out 33 years of availability to the Father so that the Father in and through Him might implement the program that had been established and agreed upon between the Father and the Son before the world was even created. And then He goes on to ask a question. Which of the activities, that is, in the life of Jesus, were the more spiritual ones? Preaching the Sermon on the Mount, raising Lazarus from the dead, or washing the disciples' feet? And then He answers, of course, there is no one activity that was more spiritual than another, for all of His activities had their origin in the Father. The Father was always acting through the Son. And that's why Jesus could say, I always do those things that please Him, John 8:29. So Jesus was merely a vessel, a human being that was entirely surrendered to God and available to God 24/7 for God to use Him, for God to think through His mind and feel through His heart and act through His hands and move about through His feet, speak through His lips and so forth. Jesus surrendered Himself so that God could live through Him. The Father could live through Him. And that's why in John 14:10, as Major cites in the chapter, Jesus summarizing this, do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak of my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me, He does the works. When you read the biographies of Jesus and the Gospels, you're seeing the acts of a man, a human being, entirely surrendered to God the Father, and God is working through him. God is speaking through him. God is performing miracles through him. And so he concludes the chapter, Major does, saying that this is also true for us. Our spirituality is simply our availability to God for His divine activity, and the form of this activity is irrelevant. Doesn't matter what the activity is, as long as its origin is in God. God's guiding it. God is directing it. It's no more spiritual to preach on Sunday morning as God is directing you, as Jesus now is directing us, than it would be to get in the floor and pray and play with our little child as Jesus would direct us to. Just spend some good quality time with our children, loving them. One is not any more spiritual than the other, provided that their origin is in Jesus and in the Father. And I love this statement. It says this, if it pleases you always and only to do what pleases God, you can do as you please. And this takes all of the pressure off of us. I pastored a church for several years that was extremely legalistic and had some bondage issues as far as legalism. They had 50 million rules and regulations. First message I preached as I took the church, and I asked, would you like me to reduce all of your rules and regulations into just one commandment? And they seemed to be leaning in. I said, love God first, love God supremely, and you can do whatever you want to do after that. Because if you love God supremely, if you fulfill that great commandment, love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, your desire, your pleasure is derived from pleasing God. Again, if it pleases you always and only to do what pleases God, you can do what you please. This is a life of liberty and freedom. And that's exactly what Jesus did, Acts 10:38. Jesus of Nazareth went about doing good, for God was with him. Everywhere Jesus went, he just did good because God the Father was with him and in him, guiding him and directing him. And the origin of his activity of doing good wherever he went was the Father. And the origin of our activity is to be both the Son and the Father. So let's talk about the origin of our real, true spirituality. In Philippians 2, verses 12 through 14, there's an interesting verse that I want to unpack for a moment. It says this, "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." Now it's telling us to work something out. For, it says in verse 13, "It is God who works in you, both to will and to do for his good pleasure." Verse 14, "Do all things without complaining and disputing." So twice we have the word work, and twice we have the word do. One of the works involves us. The other work involves God. One of the do's involves God. The other do involves us. So how do you reconcile all of this together? Well, in verse 12, that first word, that Greek word that's translated work out, literally speaks to our responsibility. In fact, it was a word, for instance, that would spoke of a student who was working out a math problem. A student who carries that math problem to its various stages, to its solution and its proper conclusion. In other words, our part in working out our salvation is not doing works of good, but like working out a math problem. It's like coming to a proper conclusion concerning our salvation, concerning justification, concerning sanctification. We need to study our Bibles and work this out until we have an understanding of these basic doctrines in the Word of God. Don't let anybody else do that for you. Don't even let me do that for you. You study the Word of God on these all-important subjects involving salvation. So the first workout is our part. We work it out like you are working out a math problem. You're praying and asking for God's wisdom and insight and understanding as you study the great doctrines of salvation in the Word of God. Now in verse 13, there's a different word for works. It's energeo. We get our word energize from, and it means to energize or work effectively. For it is God who energizes in you. Now we're talking about God who is doing a work of energizing us, moving us, motivating us, stirring us to action. And we depend upon God to do that for us. It has to do with God's enablement more than our own resources. God is the one who energizes us by the influence of the Holy Spirit. Now the words to will in verse 13 is a transliteration of a Greek word that means to desire. For God is working in you both to will or to give you the desire of your heart. We don't have to try to muster feelings and muster emotions. We don't have to be subject to crowd control from a pulpit and be worked up like a bunch of animals in a three-ring circus, friends. We can look to God to provide the mojo and the motive, the desire and the will. We look to him. Our flesh will never produce a desire for the things of God. But God can produce that desire. Delight yourself in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart. That means he will put desires in you. For it is God who works in you both to will, there's a desire, and to do of his good pleasure. And so God gives us the desire and the determination to follow through, the will. And to will and to do, and then we just follow through. So we're talking about God being the spring of action, God being the original source of our actions. That is what makes it truly spiritual. And anything less than that is not truly spiritual. And another verse that came to my mind as I was meditating was from Acts 17 and 28. Talking about Jesus, it says, "For in him we live and move and have our very being. We used to sing a song like that in some charismatic circles. In Him we live and move and have our being. And that is right out of the Word of God. So, talking about movement here, our very movements. So what is it about us that is movable or can be moved? Well, our emotions can be moved. The Bible talks about our emotions. Jesus' emotions were moved. 5 times in the Gospels, it says that Jesus was moved with compassion. We can, in our heart, be moved by the Lord Jesus Christ into an attitude of compassion towards others. He can give you and I that compassion, the same compassion that He exhibited here in the days of His flesh, He wants to exhibit right now through you and I. And that makes it really spiritual, truly spiritual. Anger is another emotion that can be incited. We can be moved to anger. The Bible talks about that in Deuteronomy 32. We can be moved with a godly fear. Hebrews 11 and 7, Moses was moved with godly fear to prepare an ark for the saving of his household. So we could be moved with a godly fear. We could be moved to jealousy. God was moved to jealousy when the people of God, the Israelites, began to worship idols, false gods, totem poles, if you please. They provoked Him to anger with their high places and moved Him to jealousy with their carved images. And God could put a jealousy in our heart for His glory, a desire for His glory. Rage. The Bible talks about being moved with rage. We could be moved in other areas, in our speech. 2 Peter 1:21, for the prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God were moved. They spoke rather as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit moved upon them and they spoke. You and I are to pray. And I've prayed right before we began this recording that I would speak as the very oracles of God, the Word of God, that God would be speaking right now through me into your heart. Because that's the way it works. That's the way Jesus operated. And that's the way we're to operate right now with Jesus through us. Our feet could be moved, or our feet could be kept from being moved. The Bible talks many times of us not being moved. Psalm 66 and 9, who keeps our soul among the living and does not allow our feet to be moved. Sometimes He wants us to simply stand, take a stand, and He'll give us the ability to have our feet firmly planted. And sometimes He wants our feet to be like the beautiful feet on a mountaintop, taking the good news and publishing salvation. On the move with the gospel in shoe leather, because God has the control over our feet. Our location can be changed. We move from place to place. I bet you most of you have moved more than once in your lifetime. There was a great move in the Bible, an epic move in the book of Genesis by one of the most important characters in the Word of God, and that's Abraham. Abraham moved from the land of the Chaldeans and he went in search of a city whose builder and maker is God. God promised him a promised land, the land of Israel. The Bible says, and Abraham moved his tent. We read in the book of Numbers that the people of Israel moved some 27 different times. It says that they moved. Wherever God guided them and wherever God directed them, they moved. Remember, in Jesus, in Him, we live and move and have our very being. He's to be moving our hands and moving our feet and moving our lips and moving our mind and moving our heart. Our minds can be moved, our hearts, our hands, our feet. Jesus needs to be in control of all of these areas. And when He is, the activity of all of these then become truly spiritual. It's a spiritual activity. So let's go to a passage of Scripture briefly and take a look at our bodies in general. The Bible says in Romans 12 and 1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Paul prayed that you and I would present our entire bodies to the Lord as a living sacrifice. All 10 digits belong to Him. All 10 toes, every brain cell, it all to be presented to the Lord. Now in Romans 6, Paul goes into this from a little bit different angle, and he talks about our members, the members of our body. Talk about our arms and our legs and our hands and our feet and all of our faculties and facilities, our minds and our hearts and our spirits. In Romans 6:13, it says, "Do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and the members, your members, as instruments of righteousness." Now I'm going to read this passage, verses 12 through 14, from three paraphrases, and I want you to really get this. This is pretty exciting. Let me read it from the Amplified Bible, the classic edition, Romans 6, 12 through 14. "Let not therefore sin rule as king in your mortal, short-lived, perishable bodies to make you yield to its cravings and be subject to its lusts and evil passions. Do not continue offering or yielding your bodily members and faculties to sin as instruments or tools of wickedness, but offer and yield yourself to God as though you've been raised from the dead to perpetual life, and your bodily members and faculties to God, presenting them as implements of righteousness." Present yourself to God from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Every aspect of you, every component of you to God. Now, in the Common English Bible, it puts it this way. "So then, don't let sin rule in your body so that you do what it wants. Don't offer parts of your body to sin, to be used as weapons to do wrong. Instead, present yourselves to God as people who have been brought back from the life from the dead, and offer all the parts of your body to God to be used as weapons to do right. Sin will have no power over you because you aren't under the law but under grace." And then the original paraphrase, the Living Bible. Listen to the way it renders Romans 6, 12 through 14. "Do not let sin control your puny body any longer. Do not give in to its sinful desires. Do not let any part of your bodies become tools of wickedness to be used for sinning. But give yourselves completely to God, every part of you. For you are back from the dead, and you want to be tools in the hands of God to be used for his good purposes. Sin need never again be your master, for now you are no longer tied to the law where sin enslaves you, but you are free under God's favor and mercy." So again, these paraphrases really bring out some of the rich nuances of taking these members and no longer yielding them to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but yielding or presenting them to God for righteousness. Now, I want to look at this passage for just a few moments and see the end of sin's reign, the breaking of sin's chains that lead to a life of holiness and a life of righteousness, a life of godliness and purity in a wicked and untoward world. First of all, there's a physical principle. Verse 12 from the New King James. "Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies that you should obey its lust." It's talking about our mortal bodies, our physical frame. We're not to let our glands be our God. You see, I know and understand, and you do as well, that God, when he made us physically, he made us with certain desires and certain drives. Every one of us have a desire to eat, and we've done plenty of that over the holidays, I'm certain. All of us have a built-in desire to sleep. All of us have a desire towards sex in some measure. Sex is not an ugly word. It's not a filthy four-letter word. Sex is designed by God. God originated it. But how many of you know it's wrong if we are glutton? It's wrong if we become lazy, take sleep and abuse it. It's wrong if we do immoral acts, sexual acts, outside of the bounds of holy matrimony. So God gave us desires, but we're not to let those physical desires control us or dominate us. We can indulge in them within the parameters of God's word, and then they will all be healthy for our welfare and our benefit and the benefit of others. We're not to let our glands be our God. Paul puts it this way in his letter to the Corinthians. He said, and everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. Therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty. Thus I fight, not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I preach to others, I myself should become a castaway. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 25 through 27. So Paul uses an illustration from an athlete, two athletes, one a runner, one a boxer. Now a runner runs and he trains and he disciplines. You know, it takes some discipline to be able to run a marathon. You have to train to run a marathon. I might be able to do a power walk for a couple of miles, but I'm really not in any condition to do a 26-mile run. And we know that there's that training and there's that discipline and that self-denial of certain things to condition yourself. For a boxer has to work and train for 6 months before he goes into the ring. And there are seemingly days on end that he's skipping rope, skip, 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 and he's punching that bag so he doesn't just beat in the air. He's disciplining himself. He's training himself. He's denying himself. So if an athlete is willing to control their bodily desires for the goal of a perishable crown, a belt, or a wreath around their head, or some sort of a statuette, how should we as believers not be more inclined to discipline our bodies so we could receive a crown of life? We should be much more motivated toward a life of victory over sin. So there is a physical principle here. Do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies. These bodies aren't to control us. God's to control these bodies. A physical principle. There's a moral principle in verse 13. And do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin. Don't yield these members to sin or unrighteousness. It's a moral, not just a physical principle now that we're speaking of. There are three great words in this sixth chapter of the book of Romans that every Christian should memorize because it's the key to the Christian life. We've taught on this in previous sessions and need to remind you periodically. It's the words know, the word reckon, and the word yield. To know, to reckon, and to yield. There are certain things that we've got to know. It says here, know you not you've been crucified with Christ. Know you not you've been buried with Christ. Know you not that you've been raised together with Christ to walk in the newness of life. We are identified with Jesus in his death, burial, and resurrection. He didn't just die for me, I died with him. He wasn't just buried for me, I was buried with him. He didn't just raise up from the dead for me. I was raised up with him to walk in the newness of life. We've got to know this. It's the first key word. Know it. Study it. Know it from all through the scriptures, from Genesis to Revelation. And it's centered right here in Romans 6. The first word is know. That's a fact. Now, the second word is reckon. The New King James would use it to count because it's an accounting term. And that's faith. To know is a fact. To reckon it or count on it is faith. That means you're counting on it to be true every moment of every day. And then the third word is to yield, or as the New King James would say, to present yourself. Now that's function. That is how it is actually lived out when we present all of our faculties to God so that he can produce true spirituality, true spiritual activity through us because he then becomes the origin of it. Anything less than that is just simply human effort. It's just religion. No, fact, reckon, faith, yield. That's the function of it. Every day we need to get up in the morning and say, you know, Chuck Foshi, at your service, Jesus. Here are my hands, here are my feet, here's my mind, here's my heart, here's my lips, here are my ears, my eyes. I present it all to you, Jesus. I want you to live your life through me every moment of this day and be mindful of it throughout the day and watch the heavens open up to you. Jesus, become alive from within and begin to live through you. God will bring us to a spiritual plane. There's a physical and there's a moral principle and a spiritual principle because this is a spiritual thing. It's not just human resolutions. We just come through New Year's Eve. many resolutions. The average resolution, New Year's resolution, lasts, they tell us, about 21 days, about 3 weeks, and we fall off the bandwagon. It's not a resolve to turn over a new leaf or to make certain changes in our lives, because that's all, again, relying on our human resolution. This is a very spiritual thing, and there are three components to it. First of all, we've got to learn to give in to God's will. It says in verse 13, yield or present yourselves unto God as those who are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. It says yield, and then twice it says unto God. He's the source of all spirituality. And if your hands are going to do something spiritual, it's because they have been yielded to God, and He is now working through them. Are we getting this? Now, there's a scripture in James 4:7. It reads like this: resist the devil and he will flee from you. Now, we believe that to be true, but quoted that way, it's not true, because you have to take verse 6 with verse 7 for verse 7 to be a reality. Submit yourselves unto God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. You could do all the resisting of the devil you want in your own strength, in your own resolve, and he will laugh in your face. He's not afraid of you. He's not afraid of me. But if we submit to God, if we present to God, if we yield ourselves to God, unto God, submit yourself unto God, then you can resist the devil and he will flee from you, because it opens a window of God's activity, of God's spirit and dynamic to flow through your life, the power of the Holy Spirit, that you will have the ability to overcome. God then is working through you spiritually. You've got to, first of all, give in to God's will. And then you've got to get a hold of God's word, verse 14. For sin shall have no dominion over you. Now, God's word says very plainly here, sin shall have no dominion over you. It doesn't matter what the preacher on television says or on Facebook says or what you hear on the radio or read in a book. There are many people that will give you the impression that we Christians sin every day in thought, word, and deed. Well, that makes us no different than the devil. Because the devil couldn't sin in any other way but thought, word, or deed. Those are the only three ways you can sin, is in thought, word, or deed, and the devil does that. And he couldn't sin any more frequently than to do it every day. So if we as Christians sin every day in thought, word, and deed, we're no different than the devil. And I've got news for you. The devil's not going into heaven. And we won't either if we buy into such theology. When preachers begin to tell you that, I encourage you, shy away, because if you buy into those kinds of teachings, friends, they can damn your soul for an eternity. When Jesus took the woman caught in adultery and began to minister to her, he didn't tell her, go and sin less. He said, go and sin no more. And the Bible here says it very plainly, sin shall have no dominion over you. In fact, in the first part of this sixth chapter of Romans, the question was asked, shall we sin that grace may abound? And emphatically, Paul says, God forbid. That's a great big divine exclamation point. How can we who are dead to sin live any longer therein? So listen, you need to shy away from that kind of teaching, because it will make you become lax in your desire or pursuit of holiness, friends. You need to be looking to God, to living his life of purity through you. Same as myself. When it came to Adam, originally, God's plan was for him to have dominion in Genesis 1:26. He was to be in control, not to be controlled. And so in the garden, Adam surrendered his sovereignty to Satan by sinning and passed it on to his posterity, you and I. Become slaves to sin. But since then, Jesus Christ came, and what was lost in the Garden of Eden was regained in the Garden of Gethsemane. What was lost by the first Adam, that is victory over sin, was regained by the last Adam, the last man, Jesus Christ. And so we understand that in Adam, we become slaves, but in Jesus, and having Jesus in us, we become freed from slavery. Jesus said, whoever commits sin is the servant of sin. If the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. That's John 8:34 and 36. I'm going to go with what Jesus said. I want to trust him to enable me to live in freedom and to be free indeed and not be a slave to sin by his grace. In other words, you've got to get a hold of the Word of God and understand what the Bible teaches about this doctrinally. The Bible here again, sin shall have no dominion, shall not have dominion over you. We got to give into God's will, present unto him everything there is about us. We got to get a hold of God's word. It says that sin will not have dominion over us. We got to go on in God's way. Verse 14 tells us, for you're not under the law, but under grace. This isn't accomplished just by legal observances. It's not accomplished by just a list of do's and don'ts. 50 things you can do and 50 things you can't do. In trying to adhere to those religious rules and regulations, even the Ten Commandments, in our own strength and in our own ability. We're not under the law, we're under grace. Now, it's the grace of God that's sufficient for every need. It's the grace of God that will take the law, that will take the essence of the Ten Commandments and write it upon the tablets of our heart. Put our hearts in sympathy with it, our hearts in sync with the law of God. That's how it's accomplished, God's will being done in us. You got to give in to God's will and get a hold of God's word and go on in God's way. It's not a legalistic system of do's and don'ts, but it's trusting in his grace for us, the abundance of God's grace to supply every need. A physical principle, don't let sin reign in your mortal bodies. A moral principle, don't yield your bodies as instruments of unrighteousness. A spiritual principle, yield or present yourselves unto God, that God will work in you and work through you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. And then when God, the Son Jesus Christ, and the Father, via the Holy Spirit, are the spring and the origin of our thoughts and our actions. The Bible says, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. Let Jesus think through you. Let Jesus love through your heart. Let Jesus work through your hands. Let Jesus' disposition, let his character, let the fruit of his spirit be demonstrated in the way you carry and conduct yourself. Just yield, just present, just submit yourself to the Lord. Then you'll have the power to resist the devil, and he'll take a run from you. He will flee from you. The origin has to be God. You know, righteousness only comes from God, and righteousness is the only thing that's going to get us through the pearly gates. But we don't have any of it of our own. The Bible says that our righteousness is as filthy rags. The Bible says it's not by works of righteousness which we have done. It's God coming. It's Jesus coming. It's the indwelling life of Christ and his righteousness that's now being lived where you and I are living, because he's living through us. We become the righteousness of God in him, and him in us. The origin. Let me read that opening statement. It's not the nature of what you do that determines the spirituality of any action, but the origin of what you do. Let Jesus be the origin of your thoughts, words, and actions, and feelings, and emotions, because you submitted them to him. Father, I pray that you'll take these truths. Help us to understand that this is the essence of Christianity. That if we don't get this, we don't get it at all. We miss the boat entirely, Lord. We can hear sermon after sermon and teaching after teaching, but if we don't understand the importance of this word know, and this word reckon, and this word yield, to understand the fact, and understand the faith in that fact and the function that applies the faith in that fact, that we will never live a life of victory, a life of an overcomer, that we'll never live a life of triumph. Teach us these fundamental truths that have been lost somewhere in the fray in your church. Restore them to your body in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Real spirituality. God bless you till next week.